heal.
No, I'm serious, babe. This weirdo just pops on my computer screen and threatens to destroy the world with a computer virus if I didn't review Despicable Me.
Look, I don't know what has been going on since my absence from the internet, but you sound crazier than me, Mr. Lewis.
I'm serious, dude. Ask the worst movies ever on YouTube. He'll tell you the exact same thing.
Man, I have some catching up to do. Did you at least catch his IP address before you froze him back to his dimension?
No.
Well, I wish I could help you, Dale. At least get some antivirus software for the next time he appears. Worked for me when that conflicker worm was passing around.
Okay, will do.
Hey, since we're on the subject, Mr. Lewis, when can I appear on the show again?
Can't hear you, Peter. We're breaking up.
Oh, quit it. You're doing that with your mouth.
What's that? Can you be a going through it? Phew. Oh! Hey everyone. Hewy is here. Welcome to Hewy's Anime Movie Reviews, the show where I review anime movies from old to recent, whether they're hand-drawn, stop-motion, or computer-generated. You know, the 1980s were a dark time for animation, but even in the 90s it got rocky. Most of it was due to competition with major studios, but viewers alike didn't know how a perfect animated feature should look and feel.
Left and right, there are various releases ranging from theatrical to the straight-to-home video section. But overseas, it was a different story.
Instead of keeping up with the Eisner, so to speak, they're trying different things out as well. But does that mean they succeeded? Well, there is one example that sticks out that you might be interested in knowing. Released over in England on August 28th, 1992, the movie is Freddie as F.R.O.7. Now before we begin, let me just say that I'll be reviewing the uncut UK edition and not the version released here in the US. I'll explain afterward. Now, on with the review.
We first begin in France with the introduction of our hero, Prince Frederick, and his dad, the King. Whereas it turns out, both share magical powers. However, the King's sister also possesses the same abilities and uses them for... what else? Evil purposes. She also has the ability to morph into other creatures like a cobra, which helps in killing off Frederick's father.
Only thing that comes to mind is where they got these special abilities. Was there a French Hogwarts around? Oh well, it doesn't really matter at this point.
Anyway, next on Aunt Messina's hit list is the prince himself, seeing that he is next in line to obtain the throne. But instead of killing him instantly, she transforms him into a frog and attempts to capture him to no success. While we are on the subject, the interesting thing to note is the design of Messina's cobra form. The way she looks is frightening in appearance, and the odd fact that they gave her cobra hips and breasts?
The look in question is interesting, but hips on a snake is very strange. At least the breasts on the thing are not like the harpies from the last unicorn, but seems quite suggestive. That's the British for you.
Hey!
And just as it looks like she's about to catch little Frederick, he is eaten by a large sea monster who scares off Messina, but not before causing a boulder to fall onto its tail.
You little ugly frog, one day I will catch up with you and destroy you, like I did your father and your mother, and then I shall be all-powerful, I shall rule the world!
Of course!
But luckily, the monster hadn't eaten Frederick, but it saved him from the coils of his evil aunt.
My name is Nessie, by the way.
Whoa, wait. Nessie? You mean that thing is supposed to be the Loch Ness Monster? That's an interesting addition.
I kid you not. Scottish accent and all, this water horse is meant to be the monster in question.
And she actually looks... kinda cute. Hell of a lot better than this.
Seeing how kind she is, Frederick uses his powers to help free Nessie, and in return, she tells him to give her a whistle in case of trouble. After that setup, He comes across a swamp of jazzy frogs whose music makes you think The Princess and the Frog should have won an Oscar for Best Music.
Where's Alan Menken or Randy Newman when you need them?
Anyway, Frederick decides to give up his princehood and live among the frogs and renames himself
as Freddie grew older,
just simply Freddie. He spends a good amount of time living with them until he becomes an adult.
He grew, and he grew, and he grew.
Look out, giant!
No, he actually grows to the size of a person because, obviously...
He is
The frogs then give him some clothing. Considering now he's at human size, but still in frog form, I guess the spell is more effective than I thought. And joins a special organization in France and becomes a secret agent. We then cut to London, where one of its monuments mysteriously vanishes. After that, we get these guys.
Hey, Yankee Doodle came to town just to buy a pony. Instead, he brought his tablet. Let's hope it's not a pony.
Oi! They're making the crows and Dumbo look PC!
I mean, who had the influence, or what caused the influence to create these two annoying freaks? I mean, they're almost as bad as those two black robots from Transformers Revenge of the Fallen! Anyway, after Buckingham Palace gets mysteriously taken away, we then see the British Secret Service, whose leader is trying to sort through this mess, but literally gets tangled in it. Seriously, how is it that hard to get wrapped up in phone cords?
Ugh, talk about the oldest cliché in the book. And that's not the last we see of it, I kid you not!
Hey, daddy-o, the Tower of London's gone! What you gonna do about it, huh? Come on, tell me what you gonna do about it!
Well, that was pointless.
Due to the heavy disappearances of London's great monuments, the head of the services decides to turn towards the French Secret Service for help from their top agent, F.R.O.7, which happens to be Freddy, and a surprising factor that they seem to be handling.
But you're a frog.
Yes? And you are the head of the British Service Secret, and I understand you have a slight, what do you call it? Problem? Disappearing buildings.
They then show him around and introduce him to two of their own agents, a martial arts expert named Daffers and a Scottish weapons expert named Scotty. Also, it's established that Daffers is the Bond girl of this animated film, and it's literally love at first sight for the two.
I'm afraid I don't have very much use for gadgets, but I like the landing area.
Oh ho ho! The toad is feeling a bit horny, no?
He can get you anything. Guns, rockets, lasers.
I'm afraid the only weapon I use is my thoughts. The powers of the mind will always overcome violence.
Well, I don't have any concealed weapons.
This is a kid's movie, right?
So, Freddy and the gang decide to head off to the horse races because he- What the hell? Pause it! Pause the movie! What the hell is that supposed to be? It's like the deformed child of Christine and Herbie with some frog DNA mixed between the two. Actually, the car is a smart car that Freddy owns and literally has a mind of its own. Her name is Nicole.
While it is cool to see a super smart sports car that can basically do anything, they never explain where it came from or how it does what it can do. They don't even have it come along during the main mission. But I'm getting ahead of myself.
Back to the film. Freddy and the gang decide to head off to the horse races because he claims to know that's where spies from major villains hang out. He runs into a bunch and manages to escape without a scratch. As he listens to their conversation, he learns that the villain responsible for the disappearing landmarks is a major crime boss called El Supremo.
Yes, we have failed to kill F.R.O.7.
Fools, imbeciles! You are under instructions to follow, observe, not to kill!
I know what you're thinking. Fat villains with Spanish names that make them sound like a pizza special don't seem that threatening. But here, they pull it off very well, and he ends up living up to his villainous position. Besides, at least they didn't do anything silly with it.
I am El Nino. All other tropical storms must bow before El Nino.
And look who happens to be coiled around his shoulders. It's the evil Messina, who happens to be in her cobra form, which for some reason she maintains throughout the rest of the movie. Apparently, she is working with him to enact her evil revenge to take over the world.
And speaking of evil...
evil mania. I'm gonna rule your world.
Oh yeah, now that's what I'm talking about.
Out of all the songs in this film, this has to be the most enjoyable out of the bunch. The tune's a little like a mesh between hip-hop and funk, and it's rather catchy. Still, one does question why the KKK and evil cults clash here. And seeing how this was already mentioned in my top 20 greatest animated villain songs countdown, I won't say anything redundant about it, except that it's a good song and proves to be entertaining.
Queen.
Oh yes, you're the queen.
The queen of evil mania.
Moving on, Freddy overhears that Big Ben is next in line to be abducted. Because he wants to face El Supremo himself, he lies to Brigadier that Windsor Castle is next, and thus, him and his army camp out there waiting for the enemy, while Freddy and his associates get taken along with Big Ben.
You know, that's actually kind of clever. Good plan, Freddy.
Unfortunately, this upsets the Brigadier, who doesn't seem to be taking the news rather well. So as it turns out, the gang find themselves heading for a deserted island somewhere in Scotland.
But I know that island. It's uninhabited.
Does this look uninhabited to you? Didn't think so.
It is revealed to our heroes that El Supremo plans to use the buildings by shrinking them to the size of a trophy and use them as batteries to a giant crystal, which will send a powerful sleeping virus across the world which will put people to sleep, allowing him to invade and enslave them. How is this possible? Well, apparently it has something to do with the fact that the crystal absorbs the fighting spirit of all of England's ancestors from years and years ago contained within the famous monuments.
That's actually pretty creative. Kudos to the writers.
When the last required building is captured, Edinburgh Castle, Freddy and Scotty are thrown into a pool of sea monsters, while Daffers is brainwashed into a mindless follower of El Supremo and Messina.